Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's good to see you today, and welcome to our worship service. We're happy to again welcome our good friends this morning from the Faith Community Covenant Church, and we all look forward to when we greet you again as one family of God's children together. Our church council will meet Tuesday, September 8th at 7 p.m., and as always, it is open to all members that wish to attend. New members will be received into full membership with First Covenant on Sunday, September 13th, and if you are interested in joining, please speak with Pastor George. We would like to give you an update on our pastoral search committee. We have received notice from another minister that he will be receiving his resume soon, and we are also waiting to receive more information from the Covenant on candidates that have impressed us so far. Also, we are pleased and will be welcoming Jack and Laura Harden from Faith Community to serve on our committee. And I just want to remind you, the offering plates are on the usher's table, and thank you for your faithfulness. And after the service ends, the usher will dismiss us from the back row forward. And now, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, today we pray to you with thanksgiving in our hearts. Thankful to you for our two congregations going through our many changes and following your guidance for us to come together as one. We pray for your continued blessing and guidance to do your work as we grow together in your grace. We pray in thy holy name. Amen. And now, if you would please stand and join with me in our call to worship. O come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us sing joyful noises to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving.
Let us sing joyful noises to him with songs of praise.
Our hymn of praise is We Have Heard the Joyful Sound.
We have heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves us, Savior.
Thank you.
God our Father, complete the work you have begun and keep the gifts of your Holy Spirit active in the hearts of these young people. Make them ready to live your gospel and eager to do your will. May they never be ashamed to proclaim to all the world Christ crucified, living, and reigning forever and ever. Amen. Our response is to God be the glory, just the praise chorus. Father, it is so good that we can be in your house this morning to worship you, to come from the busyness of this week and the things that we have been through this week, that we can quiet our hearts, that we might truly worship you in spirit and in truth. We love you, Lord. We love you with our whole hearts. And we know that you love us more than we will ever know in our lives. And you call for us to have a relationship with you, to allow you to be so much a part of our lives that we can hear that still, small voice that we call the Holy Spirit, that speaks to us and walks with us and never leaves us or forsakes us. Our Father, we pray for those who are shut in this morning in our parishes. You know their heart. And may through your Holy Spirit they know that we're praying for them right now, for your blessing to be upon their lives. We pray for those who are here today, who are going through testing and and they're knowing that they have to face surgery. We just pray for the power of the Holy Spirit to show them your love. We pray for those, dear God, who are going through a hard time in grieving. And we're so aware of your scripture. It says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And dear God, we just claim that. Even when we hurt inside, we claim that. Father, we just pray for our young people. We're searching and longing for answers to life. And we know, dear God, that you have the answer. And yet we know that there are forces that are pulling our kids, pulling them away from the truth. The truth of your divine mercy. And they're lost. Dear God, help us as parents and grandparents to be witnesses of your saving grace. Oh God, let them see Jesus in our lives, that they can see the difference. And we follow you. Father, we pray for our nation, we pray for our leaders. You tell us in Holy Scriptures to pray for those over us. So, dear God, we just pray for discernment. We do pray for the healing of our broken nation. Thank you, O God, that we have this wonderful opportunity to be able to come into your house. Just you. And we give you the praise and the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
Thank you.
is a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 5, beginning with verse 1, the Beatitudes. Our response after the reading will be, thanks be to God. Our reading is an insert in our bulletin this morning. Would you please join me and let us read our Gospel together. When Jesus saw the crowd, he went up the mountainside, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. And then he began to speak and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you for falsehood on your own account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets, the Lord will be for you. Dear friends, this is the gospel of the Lord for today. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God grant us now the serenity, the inner peace to accept the things in life we simply cannot change, the courage through the power of the Holy Spirit to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength, and our precious Redeemer, and the body of Christ says, Amen. As the end of August begins to come around, there are three major events that Trudy and I, along with thousands of other people in the valley, look forward to. The first one is the Canfield Fair that has been canceled this year. The second is band shows at our local school prior to football. And yes, you guessed it, football. Some high schools will have football for the kids and some will not. It's still up in the air. But who would have believed, heaven forbid, that college football would be scrapped? I cannot believe that two of my favorite teams, YSU and Ohio State, would not be playing this year. I think by now you know I love football, but I have to confess, when Ohio State plays, guess what? I simply cannot watch the game. Because my blood pressure goes from being normal to stroke stage. But I don't have to worry because Trudy watches the game and I know exactly what is happening even though I'm in the study or in the bedroom watching television. Good or bad, because this is what I hear. I hear Trudy say, oh no, 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 come on you guys, what's wrong with you? Or I will hear her say, oh yes, 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 yes! Way to go, guys! And then she would clap her hands and I would know that Ohio State made a touchdown. I always would say to Trudy, now when the team gets to just 3 minutes out, call me. I can handle this and I'll watch the rest of the game with you. I read some time ago about this football team that lost their last game of the year by the score of 78-0. The next day, the coach gathered his players around him. He didn't yell at them. He didn't tell them what they did wrong. In fact, he didn't say anything. As the team gathered around him, he just sat in total silence for over an hour. The team was so moved, some of them began to have tears running down their faces, for they knew how devastated their coach was. They could feel his pain. And finally, the coach got up, left the players, he went into the office, and when he finally came out, he was holding a football. And with tears running down his face, he said, "Now kids, this is known as football. This is a football." And with that, he dismissed the kids for another season. Words. Words I'm sure those kids will never, never forget. I'm sure that when their grandparents, they're going to say to their grandchildren who are playing football, they'll tell that story. Now, beloved, this is what's known as going back to the basics of the game. And this is exactly what Jesus was doing with the Sermon on the Mount. The people were following Jesus wherever he went, and Jesus didn't know if they were following him because of his teachings or because of the power that he had to touch people's lives and make a difference for their lives. So one day, after calling his disciples, James and John, to join his ministry team, the crowd became so large that he walked up the side of the mountain near the Sea of Galilee. He sat down and he began to share with them what was really important in life, the basics of life. He said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy." Jesus said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." The Sunday after I buried my niece at Arlington National Cemetery, we worshiped at the National Cathedral, and the gospel for the day was the gospel that we read just a moment ago in the Beatitudes. And on the front of the bulletin were the words, "Blessed are they that mourn, for someday they will be able to laugh again." Words. Words. Powerful words. Words of hope. Words that we need to hear today. Words that are positive to us when we are hurting. Words that are important to us in life. Powerful words. Many years ago, Ann Blight, a popular movie star at the time, was invited to give the keynote address at a fundraiser for cancer research. And her speech electrified the crowd. She spoke about the power that words have on our lives, and how words impact our life, for good or bad. And Anne White started her address by quoting the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 1. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And then she said, "Since then, there's been a billion and a billion billion and millions and millions of words that have been spoken. Soft words, hard words, cold words, warm words. There are words that sing and jump and skip and dance with joy. She said, words are so important in life. And how we need positive words. You see, beloved, a word can excite, or it can depress. A word can lift us up, or push us down and kill our dreams. A word can make us glad and happy, or the wrong words will make us angry and sad, and sometimes even afraid. Words can inspire our souls, or they can crush and defeat us. Words can motivate, encourage, or they can smash and kill our hope. Words, words. In our world today, in our country, in our valley, in our nation, it's filled with hatred and violence and burning and killing. And oh, how we need to hear a word today about the divine mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ from the Word of God. For we are a mercy of our words. Words are so important, so powerful. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Powerful words to live by. Listen to these words again from Jesus sitting on that mountainside near the lake of Galilee. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are peacemakers. Oh, how we need peacemakers today. For they will be called children of God. The part of the gospel lesson for today that I did not read was these words from the Gospel of Matthew, the 5th chapter, verses 13 through 15. Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Then Jesus said, let your light shine before others, so they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. You are the salt of the earth. Words. Powerful words. You. We were the light of the world for Jesus. Words. Powerful words. How important it is as Christians that we guard what comes from our mouths. For what we say can build up, can build someone up, or it can tear someone down in a second. Our words can give hope and build confidence, or our words can destroy and hurt. Now, I want you to love me here. You see, friends, as Christians, Christians should never use the name of the Lord in vain. Can you say amen? Because it offends God. Plus, you lose your witness. Think of that. You lose your witness. Christians should never tell dirty jokes. Because first of all, your friends know that you're Christian. And if a dirty joke comes out of your mouth, you lose your witness. Friends, I want you here to say the kids are looking for answers. And I'm going to tell you about that Peter in a sermon. And if they don't see it in you, and they know that you're here, what are you going to do? Christians should never put people of other races and cultures down. Because if you believe the Bible says we're all made in the image and the likeness of God, words are so important. You know, I was excited this week through all the negative news that we hear all week long. I don't watch the news very much anymore. Because you can turn it on Monday, you turn it on Friday, you hear the same thing. Amen?
Amen?
But I applaud the peace accord between Saudi Arabia and Israel. You know, what a step. And it reminded me that the last time Trudy and I was in the Holy Land, I had breakfast with our driver, who was a Palestinian Christian, and our guide, who was of a Jewish faith. And over breakfast, they shared how real peace would come to the Middle East only when they would just sit down and talk words and get to know one another. Rather than try to get them just to sign a peace agreement. And you know, friends, I can remember many years ago, I didn't take the advice of my wife and I should have. But I ran for a state office. And a good friend of mine, my congressman at the time, was Don Beans. And he said to me after I filed, he said, George, whatever you do, watch your words. Watch your words. And then he said something that I have never forgotten. He said that the only way you can win this race is to destroy the character of your opponent. You don't deserve to be elected. Just tell them what you're going to do. Your opponent's going to tell you what he's going to do, and let the voters decide. I have never forgotten that. Listen to these words. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believed in him might not perish, but have everlasting life. Words of hope. Powerful words. Words of love. Yesterday afternoon, I was talking to Greg on the phone, and I noticed that someone was trying to call him. And I recognized it was one of my kids that I had confirmed in the seventh grade, that I have not seen in 25 years. And what startled me was he called and hung up. And then he called and hung up. And the third time he called, the Holy Spirit said to me, he said, George, you better get off the phone and take it. So I said to Greg, I gotta go. And when I said hello, here was this young man, 38 years old. He said, Pastor George, I'm so broken. I've lost all hope. I've walked away from Jesus for my confirmation. I don't know what to do. Can you just give me a word of hope? He was out in California. I was in Youngstown. And he just cried like a baby. And my prayer was, Lord, give me words, give me words, give me wisdom, give me words. And the thought that came through my heart was asking if he was to recommit his life to Christ. And I called him by name and I said, do you want to come home? Welcome home to Jesus. He said, oh, Pastor George, that's my only hope. That's my only hope. He said, I didn't know who to call. I lost all my friends, he said. But he said, I knew that you would talk to me. Give me a word. And I led him in a prayer of salvation. And he cried his way all the way through it. We got a wedding rehearsal last night. I want to tell you that was the hardest wedding rehearsal I've ever given in my life because I couldn't keep my mind on what I was doing. You understand? I was afraid. And when we got home last night, he had called back. He said to me, Pastor George, I have just a little piece, and I'm reading the Gospel of John. Thank you. I didn't sleep at all last night. I want you to know I'm very tired this morning. And it's for this reason. I thought, what if he hadn't seen Jesus in my life during the confirmation 9 months we were together? What if he hadn't seen Jesus in his teachers? Words. Words, dear friends. They will either lift up in the name of Jesus, with you in your hardest career. I don't know, we all go there. We all go there. You can do the Lord. And if you don't know where to go, just open up the Gospel of John and be reminded of these words of the Apostle in the beginning. Say it with me. In the beginning was the Lord. And the Word was God. Now, friends, you've heard me say this before, but I want you to hear me say it again. God loves you. I want you to say that. Will you say that with me? God loves me. Say it again.
God loves me.
Say it one more time.
God loves me.
Do you believe? Do you believe? Oh, friends. Watch your words and be a witness. Be a witness to these kids, like the one that called me yesterday. And then away from the church for 25 years. Said I just knew the room. The scripture that I want to leave with you is the one in the Gospel of Matthew, just before Jesus ascended to heaven. He said, go make disciples. baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teach them everything that I have commanded you. And then it gives the greatest promise, and I think we miss it as a church. He says, lo, I'll be with you forever. I'll be with you forever. Shall we pray? Father, thank you for your word. The word that reminds us of the divine mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. That we can have a relationship with you. And call us to be a witness, to be the light of the world, to let people see Jesus in the way that we live our lives every day. The things we say on the phone, the things we say to one another. Oh God, let me see Jesus in our lives. That we might be an instrument of bringing one person, just one person, to be saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. So we'll give you the praise and the wonderful, wonderful name of Jesus our Lord. Let us stand and join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament, the Apostles' Creed, as printed in our bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, our only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died and was buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen.
Our closing hymn is a great gospel hymn, wonderful, wonderful words of mine. Let us sing.
Thank you.
from Faith Community Evangelical Covenant Church. Where are you at? Would you raise your hands? There you are. I just want you to know that we here at First Covenant know that you haven't made a decision to make 2 weeks from today. I want you to know that we're in prayer with you, and we just pray for God's blessing to just be upon you as you discern the future of your church and your faith community. I want you to know that if you vote to come this way, we will receive you with open arms. First Covenant, can you say amen?
Amen.
And we want you to know that you're welcome. We want you, if you come, we want you to know that we want you to get involved, become part of our ministry, where we can become one together. And I just want to ask those from Faith Church to stand, because I want to pray for you right now. We need you now. Father, we just give you thanks for Faith Community. They have been searching their hearts for these many weeks, and now they've come within just 2 weeks of taking this vote of deciding the future of their faith community. So, dear God, pour out your Holy Spirit, and we just pray that you will bless them, fill them with your love, give them discernment, and we give you the praise and the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Just a couple more announcements before I let you go. The September-October issue of the Envelope is in the North End. Mike Brock goes over from Faith, so Faith Community, take your Envelopes with you today. They're out there. First Covenant, if you follow the Envelope, they're there for you to take. Next Sunday, I've asked that I could be off so we could go home and be with them. And so Reverend Don Christensen, who's retired from Canfield United Methodist Church, will be the preacher next Sunday. He's a wonderful, wonderful preacher. I'm so excited. I call him my son because he was in the 10th grade in our very first church. And then I was there when I performed his wedding, their wedding. I baptized their children. I was there when he was ordained. And I was shocked when the bishop appointed him following in Canfield when I retired. And then he served 10 years there. He's now on the staff of Western Reserve. But he's a wonderful preacher, and you do not want to miss him because he's fantastic, because he's my son. Hey, God bless you. Be a witness. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. In the name of the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and the body of Christ says, amen.